morning, friends. So by now, we are well into the start of the new year, and I do hope that you've been successful in getting back into the swing of things. For myself, life has been quite rewarding. Juanita has just completed her honours in theology and should start her master's next month. I've really enjoyed developing this series on biblical behaviour and the interaction that it's brought about with some of you wanting to know more about certain aspects of what we've been chatting about. And I thank you all for that. Yes, in our series, we've covered obedience, we covered hope, we've covered trustworthiness, or as I like to call it, ethics. And today, for the fourth element, we're going to be covering love. But first, let us just close our eyes and thank the Lord for everything that He's provided us with. Let us pray. O Heavenly Father, we live in a world where the security we once seemed to enjoy has been eroded away, and so many dark clouds of COVID seem to be looming on the future, on this unpredictable horizon. All at once, what seemed secure and reliable has evaporated like the morning mist. But Lord, we praise your name, and we entrust our future in your safekeeping, knowing that your love surrounds us and that your grace is sufficient, no matter how dark the circumstances of life may appear. Thank you, Lord, that you hold us in the palm of your hand, and nothing can snatch us from that secure position. Father, we pray that our hearts may be filled with love for you and love for our neighbour, and that our words and deeds may always focus on your love. May we learn day by day to prevent our eyes from focusing on the trials and tribulations of this world. Help us rather to look to Jesus, knowing that in all things he is the victor, and we are securely positioned in him through time and through eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Well, as I said, today we're going to be talking about love. Almost 4 years ago, the church leaders met with Wesley to establish a DNA for our church. And love, learn, live became our vision, purpose, and the process for Pretoria North. Proverbs 29 verse 18 says that where there is no vision of God's love, the people may perish through their ignorance of God, for crime and sin will run wild. Love needs to be our motivation for everything we do, because, wait for it, God is love. As Christians, we need to believe in the power of love. But more than that, we need to be people who want to participate in this love by the way we live. Our spirituality must reflect our love for God, our Father. So how do we go and reflect this God's love? How does it work in our lives? Well, firstly, by putting into practice what he has taught us through his word. And how do we do that? By adopting God's spiritual values. And what are these values, you might be asking? Well, I'm sure you've all heard them. They are love, joy, patience, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, but the greatest of all of these is love. If we don't love God and do not love our neighbor, we do not have the Holy Spirit in our lives, and we cannot be obedient to God's word. You see, we are made by love, in love, and for love. We are made by love, in love, and for love. Believe it or not, humans are creatures of love. This might sound outrageous in a world that has seen global terrorism and the brutality of many, many wars. We carry the scars and vivid images of expanding mushroom clouds over Japan and the Twin Towers crumbling in dust and fire. Faced with these atrocities, how can we speak of love and a loving God? Well, perhaps that's because over time, we've come to understand love not as an emotionally warm feeling of love and commitment to each other, but rather as a deep power of greed that shares our loves, our lives, and flows into all our actions. The crucial question is not whether we love or not, for in the end, we cannot escape our own nature. We will love, for we are helpless to do otherwise. The question is, what or who will we love? And what our loving will do to us and the world around us? God's fundamental nature is love, for God is love. And we are created in his image and likeness. So therefore, love is the basic raw material, the raw matter of our spirit. But in this fallen world, corrupted by sin, we have become corrupted lovers. Our hearts have become warped, twisted, broken and shattered by sin. Our love has turned in every wrong direction, misapplied, misused, mainly due to the influence of this materialistic world. In some people and in some societies, the expression of love has led to fear and terror. But no matter how defaced or ugly Love has become, it remains love in some form or another. Just as gold can be melted down, it can be beaten into new shapes, even buried, but none of these acts can change the essential nature, for it remains gold. In the same way, our inner sense is love, regardless of what we do, what we have done, or where or who we have become. So when we speak of people becoming unloved, we are really describing this misguided love within them. You see, Jesus' invitation for us is to enter into the kingdom. It was not addressed to those who clearly are kingdom people, but to those who suffered from the maladies of disordered love. The other religious leaders of the day challenged Jesus when they saw him surround himself by sinners, with the dregs of society, one might say. But in Matthew 9, verses 12 and 13, Jesus reminds us that it is not the healthy that need a doctor, but those who are sick. He tells us that he has come to call on sinners and not the righteous. We sometimes find God's mercy so attractive, but yet so difficult to grasp or even to accept. G.K. Chesterton once said that the really great lesson of the story of the Beauty and the Beast is that a thing must be loved before it can become lovable. A thing must be loved before it is lovable. Profound words, I believe. A person must be loved before that person can be lovable. Some of the most unloved people I have known got that way because they thought that nobody loved them. The fact of the matter is that unless and until we feel ourselves loved, we cannot love. That's not only a principle of theology, but of psychology and sociology as well. Just as abused children grow up to abuse their children, loved children grow up to love their children. Loved persons are able to love. Unloved persons are not. Christianity says something startling. It says that God loves and accepts us just as we are. He loves you and I as we are. Therefore, we can love and accept ourselves, and in doing so, love and accept others around us. God's love removes the barrier that separates us from him by cancelling the debt of sin so we can enjoy a loving relationship with him. Aren't those wonderful words? You see, God's love removes our sin as though they never existed, and his love touches every part of our lives. Nothing, no calling, no circumstance, no adversity, no advancement, no pain or promotion, no status escapes the brushstrokes of God's love. God's love bleeds into every fabric and touches every single corner of our lives. There is nowhere we can go to escape the love that he has for you and I. There is no problem that we will encounter that has not been touched by his love. There is no advancement that we can make where God is not already there. Even when our world falls apart, we can say, God, I don't know why this is happening. I don't understand it. But I'm glad to know you love me and you are constantly by my side. Thank you, Father. When we have someone who loves holding on to, it doesn't matter what your circumstances are or what the future might hold. When you are there for them and they know that you are there for them, their love matters. When you're in the arms of a loving God, the same thing applies. You have been consumed by His love and all is well. You are confident in His arms, safe and rewarded. You see, God's love is personal, for He is capable of loving and being loved. He loves each one of us unconditionally. God's love is not just simply for mankind as a mass. No, it is a sentimental, wonderful love. It is a soft feeling. It is a wonderful feeling, a warmth that comes from within. No, God's love loves us for who we are. When Karl Barth, the famous German theologian, visited the United States, a student at a seminary asked, "Mr. Barth, what is the single most important truth you have learned as a theologian?" was the question. Barth thought about it for a moment, and then he replied, "The most important thing I've learned is this. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, this I know, for my Bible tells me so." Jesus' love is the central affirmation of our Christian faith. It is the cornerstone of the nature of God. Remember, when God says, "I love you," He is saying that you matter to Him. You are valuable to Him, regardless of what other people might think. He loves you because God is love. Jesus described Himself as a teacher and a healer. He brought out the broken. He sought out the broken, not to pity them, but to transform them. It was to people like this that He came, proclaiming the kingdom to every lost soul He met. He offered healing, both spiritual and physical, to the most savage sinner and the very lost and terrified soul that He could find. In Luke 11, 13b, Jesus reminds us that no matter how unloved we may feel, the Father still loves us enough to have the Holy Spirit abide in those who ask Him. If we want our lives transformed from the inside, we must allow the Holy Spirit to open our lives to the healing power of God's love, allowing it to flow through us and allow Him to reshape our lives. But how do we go about this, you might be asking? Well, I think that Psalm 1 has the answer. The psalm describes the joy of those who find themselves like trees rooted beside a stream. As the living water soaks into them, they discover that they are bearing fruit naturally. The Spirit fulfills their desire to bear the fruit. The spiritual fruit of joy, love, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, and self-control are available to all of us once we allow the Holy Spirit to transform our lives. And just as the tree makes no conscious decision to grow fruit, the tree, like us, simply needs to be located in the right environment. The tree needs to be in the right place. Then there are those barren trees who persist in their self-interest and pursuit of pleasures and allow their soul to run rampant and thus locate themselves far from the living water of the stream. And unlike the fruitful trees, they become chaff, empty shells, and cast into the fire, all because they were located in the wrong environment. All because they were located in the wrong environment. There are two verses in John's Gospel that for me fully define God's love for humanity and the love that we should have for each other. John 3:16, and I'm sure that most of you know this one off by heart. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Then my second verse is John 15, and I'm reading from verse 13. No one has greater love than this, than someone who would lay down his life for his friend. In Matthew 5, Jesus invites his disciples, that's you and I, to a life of wholeness, filled with love, virtue, integrity, meaning, purpose, and direction. And the result of this way of life is the ability to love others fully and so fulfill the law of the prophets, which in Matthew 7 says, in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. Friends, I believe right now in South Africa, that is what we need. Do to others as you would have them do to you. You see, it is not enough to hear the word or even to know it off by heart. We must live it by putting it into practice. How easy it is to pick up your Bible and read it each day, or to listen to a sermon, and very shortly thereafter forget what we've just heard or read, and not live out the meaning through the obedience and love we have for Jesus. We need to transform those meaningful words into our lives. Jesus has thrown open the gates of his kingdom, wide open, and invites all of us, the broken, the failures, the bitter, the weak, the wicked, the sinners, along with everyone else. He offers this invitation because of the immense love that he has for us. He longs to shower his love on us, and he longs for us to grow in our ability so that we might love him more and love each other more and more every day. In closing, for me, Ezekiel 36, verse 26 says it all. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. Isn't those wonderful words? This invitation comes with a profound challenge. We have an invitation to live in a community of God, a life that is abundant, deep, rich, and flourishing, filled with love. This is a life you were born to live, a life filled with joy and purpose, and love and wonder and beauty and the love for our Jesus, for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Christ's invitation has not been made lightly. It is born out of God's immense love for you and I. This is not an invitation to be accepted lightly, for it will change your entire life. It will reach out into every corner of your life and embrace your very existence. My challenge to you today is this. Will you accept this invitation? Will you accept Jesus' invitation for the Holy Spirit to come into your life and transform you? Amen. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for your steadfast love towards us all. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. We thank you, Lord, for your comfort and for your grace, which is renewed every morning. We thank you, Lord, that you are there for us, that you are a God who cares and loves each and every one of us. Each one of us, that we are so loved by you, Lord, that we know we are carried in the palm of your hand. As we are poor of spirit, we need your love. We need your strength. When we are weary, we need your strength to carry us through these troubled times. Comfort us, Lord. We thank you that we have an opportunity to rest in your arms of mercy and grace. We praise your holy name, Lord, and we ask that your grace will cover us, and it will be perfect in our weakness. Heavenly Father, your steadfast love towards us is very precious, and we love you, and we praise that you will help us to love more and more, that with the passing of every day, we may grow stronger in your love and stronger for the love of our neighbor. We pray this all through Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, that brings us to the end of today's grace message, the message of love. But now let us all hold each other's spiritual hands as we say the grace. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen. Friends, as we close, I leave you with one thought. Think of someone who needs your special love to go today. Go out and help them by listening, encouraging, and giving them all the love you can, and then try to give them more. I'm asking you to go out, pick up your telephone, and phone that special person, and just talk to them, or send them an email or a WhatsApp to let them know that you love them and that you are thinking of them. Blessings to you all for the days and weeks that lie ahead. Stay safe and know that God loves you. Till we meet again next Sunday. Shalom.